guys, it's Tammy from Shrinking Bad at DS, and today is Friday, June 7th. I had traditional duodenal switch surgery in 2017. I started my pre-op diet February 19th of 2017 at 260 pounds. I had traditional duodenal switch surgery on March 9, 2017 at 248 pounds, and today I weigh 124 pounds. I also had full skin revision surgery from shoulders to knees with Dr. Francis. I had my DS with Mexicali Bariatric Center in Mexicali, Mexico. I had my skin revision on January 22nd of 2019, my 48th birthday, with Dr. Francisco Salceda in Monterrey, Mexico. For some reason, I am all discombobulated today. I don't know why, but I'm having a hard time putting my thoughts together coherently. Anyway, I weigh 124. For those of you who are with me frequently, you know that I range between 120 and 124, or 120 and 125. And so, still my normal maintenance range. I've been carving it up lately with sushi rolls and toast, and we had company, and so yeah. I have not been the best. So all I need to do to drop this 4 pounds, if I decide to do it, is drop my carbs and increase my protein. Works like a charm. Less than a week, all 4 pounds will be gone. I think part of the other reason, another part of the reason that I was carving so hard is, I don't know if it's perimenopause or what, but I seem to have a long time where I had the carb cravings. See what I mean? I don't know what the heck. What the heck is wrong with me today? Hopefully you can decipher what it is I'm trying to express. Anyway, I think I had an extra long period of carb cravings this month, so that did not help. Anyway, I'm not worried. My clothes fit fine. I wear them fairly body conscious, so there's not a lot of extra space in them, but 5 pounds. I can feel a little bit of a difference, but it's not like I've eaten myself out of my clothes or anything. And it's not even 5 pounds, 4 pounds. So, anyway, several of you said that you did want to hear about our upcoming trip next year. It's not our next trip. Our next trip is 4 weeks from tomorrow, and that's cruise to Alaska with some friends, and that's just a quickie 1 week. We do that one, I think it's like the fourth time I've done it. It's kind of our go-to trip for years where we're busy, we've had big trips at other points of the year, or we're doing lots of other trips. And for instance, this year we're doing the Alaska cruising in July, but then in September we're going to London for 10 days. And then next spring we need to go back east or down south for a week to do college trips, and then next summer we're gonna do 3 weeks in the United Arab Emirates and Southern Africa. So that's the trip that I was talking about, that I'm, you know, getting ready now. And the reason we have to do it so far in advance is because some of the places that we are staying on safari only have 3 tents or 4 tents or, you know, whatever. They're not big camps. And so you really have to book far in advance when you want two of them. You're taking over 2/3 or half of the entire camp. So, yeah. And we also like to have, we like to have our own vehicle and driver in the camps, our own safari vehicle. And that's because I've been on safari several times, and oftentimes the camps will include shared safari vehicles. So it'll be up to maybe 8 people. And the safari vehicles are open vehicles, and usually they're kind of like stadium seating, tiered jeeps, long jeeps, and they'll have the driver and the tracker in the front, or they'll have the driver in the front, the tracker sits in a little seat up on the hood, And then, so there'll be the driver. There's a seat next to the driver that a guest can sit in. Then there's a bench seat behind that, a bench seat sitting up a little bit further behind that, and then one more in the backpack. So, yeah, usually there's 8 to 10 people. And not everyone travels the same, as we all know. And not everyone has the same level of interest for various things. And when you're on safari, it's very exciting to have the big animals, the lions and the elephants and all that kind of thing. But I find it equally as interesting and certainly educational to pay attention to the small ones. The birds, the bugs, the dung beetles, the plants, that kind of thing. And also, sometimes you'll get to something like, last time I was Brian and I were there, we stumbled upon a leopard kill. And he had just killed a gazelle and was dragging it up the tree because they stash their kills in trees so that other predators cannot sneak up on them while they're eating. And so they'll drag it up a tree and then they'll eat it up there. And they'll leave it there. You know, first they'll eat the interior because that's the part that is going to spoil fastest. And for anybody who hunts or anything like that, or if you've grown up on a farm and you butcher your own animals, you know that you have to gut them and bleed them. And so that's basically what the cheetah does, is gut and bleed its prey. And so it eats that stuff first. And then it can stash the animal in the tree. It can keep it there for 3 days, maybe 4 days, and just keep coming back and eating it. And so we found one that was just beginning that process. And we stayed with that leopard for, gosh, like 2.5 hours. And not everybody's going to want to do that. So that is a reason that we really like to have our own vehicle. Also, again, it's not an easy trip, and sometimes you'll get couples or families or people who aren't necessarily getting along anymore by that point in their trip, and they're sniping at one another, or they're, you know, just in some way. I've been with women who were kind of screamy, you know, if they thought that an animal was getting too close to the vehicle. And the animals can get, I mean, they'll walk literally beside the vehicle, brushing the vehicle. And it's safe. They don't see you as prey when you're in the vehicle. They see you as a part of that vehicle, and they don't recognize that as prey. So you're fine, even though it's open. And I mean, they're close. You could lean over, reach down, and pet it. If you did that, of course it would see you as prey. But I've been in vehicles where women are like, oh my God, we gotta go, we gotta leave, I don't feel safe, and that kind of thing. So, yeah, I don't know what to share. Because you just never know what you're gonna get. So, that's another reason why we book way in advance, because as you can imagine, when you're out in the middle of nowhere, it's not like there is a huge number of vehicles. There is a dearth of vehicles, actually, available. And so we want to make sure that we are able to get what we want, where we want, when we want. So that's what we're going to do. We are going to leave here June of 2020, and we'll leave from Portland. We're taking Spence and one of his buddies that has been a friend of his forever, we'll fly from here to San Francisco, and then San Francisco, Dubai, Johannesburg. The reason we're doing it that way is because we're flying on Emirates. And we want to fly on the A380, which is the big, giant airplane that is fully double-decker. None of us have been on the A380 yet. And so, we would like to do that. Normally, we would fly out of Seattle, because it's closer. But the planes that Emirates flies out of Seattle are 777s, not A380s. So, they're not as big and dramatic. So, we're willing. You know, it's an hour, well, it's like a 45-minute flight up to Seattle. It's like an hour and a half down to San Francisco. So it's not that big of a deal to go out of San Francisco instead. So we'll fly Portland to San Francisco, We have about a 4-hour layover. We'll get on the plane and then we'll fly 15 hours and 40 minutes to Dubai. Long flight. So because of that, we're going to break the trip in Dubai for a night. There's a couple of hotels that are within security, and so we don't have to collect our checked luggage. We don't have to go through customs. We don't have to go through immigration. We just take our hand carry, get off the plane, and the hotels are right there by the airport lounges within security. So we'll stay there at that night. I think we land at like 7:30 at night, and then our flight leaves at 9, I think, the next morning. So it'll be plenty of time. And then, so our 9 o'clock flight the next morning is Dubai to Johannesburg, and that's another 9 hours. So that's why we're breaking, because 24 hours, no, 25 hours, non-stop flying. Well, and then you add in the San Francisco flight. It's exhausting. I mean, we just been ridiculous. So we'd much rather get there feeling good than not. It's, a, you know, too far to go, too expensive of a trip to feel trashed for the first half because you spent all that time flying straight through when you didn't have to. So we'll get to Johannesburg, and we're just overnighting quickly there. We get in at 4:30 in the evening, or afternoon. By the time we clear customs and immigration, we collect our luggage and all of that, it'll probably be, gosh, 6. And then, for that reason, we're not going to stay in the city. We're going to stay right at the airport. There's a great airport hotel right there at the airport. It's an intercontinental. It's very nice. Has an indoor pool and great food and a nice lounge and bar and everything. So, we'll just stay right there. And then the next day, we hop on a little charter plane from Johannesburg to the Southern Kalahari. It's the part of the Kalahari Desert that is in South Africa, and it's known as the Green Kalahari because it's not as dry and barren as the northern part that's in Botswana. It's also the part of the Kalahari where the meerkats are, and I've been to the Kalahari before, but I was in the northern section, so I've never seen a meerkat. So I'm pretty excited. I'd like to kiss a meerkat on the nose, frankly. Don't think that's going to happen, but a girl can always dream. So we'll be there for 3 nights, and the place we're staying has horses, and so we can do a horseback safari. We have an astronomy expert who will be there, and so he's going to take us out for an astronomy evening. Stars in the African sky are absolutely amazing. When you get out into the bush like that, there's nothing around. There is no light pollution at all, and the stars just stretch from horizon to horizon. It's incredible. And the boys have never seen anything like that. So we will have an astronomy evening out on the dunes, and then we will also have a bush picnic out there at some point. And that's in addition to the usual game drives and that kind of thing. And then we'll fly back. We'll be there 3 nights. We'll fly back to Johannesburg again, spend the night at the Intercontinental at the airport. Africa is very much one of those you can't get there from here kinds of places, and all roads lead to Johannesburg. So that's what we'll be doing. Back to Johannesburg. So one night back in Johannesburg, it's like 24 hours, I think, and then we will catch another plane the next day. Just a regular scheduled aircraft up to Maun in Botswana. And it's, I say it's the biggest town. It's probably the only town of any, note in northern Botswana. Habarani is the capital, and it's down south, and it's much larger. But Maun is just like this little outpost up in the north, and it's where you pretty much go through if you're going up into the local. So we'll fly into Maun and switch to a little charter plane and fly up to the very north part of the Okavango Delta, just right by an area called Moraine. And we're staying at a lodge that is on a lagoon, so it's in an area that has year-round water. The Okavango Delta does not generally have year-round water. You can pretty much watch the water come in every year and watch it recede. So we will be there during flood season, So there will be water in other parts of the Okavango as well this time, but this particular place always has water. And as a result, it also has resident hippos right outside your tents. And so that'll be really fun for the boys. And they'll get to go fishing. We'll do, of course, our regular game drives, but we'll also be able to do game floats, I guess. I was going to say game drives by boat, but game floats by Makora, which is dugout canoe, the traditional dugout canoes, and also by motorboat. Motorboats are wild. I would much rather just do it with the Makora, even though you can't go as far. I think it's a lot more, I don't know, interesting and relaxing. So we'll be there for 3 days, and from while we're there, we are going to take a helicopter one morning, and it's going to take us out into the middle of nowhere, and we are going to pick up a hot air balloon, and we will go on a hot air balloon ride for the rest of the morning, and I'm not sure if the hot air balloon brings us back to camp or if we helicopter back or whatever. Somehow, we'll have the hot air balloon, we'll have some drinks in the balloon, we'll land, we'll have breakfast, and then we'll come back to the camp about noon that day. So that'll be fun. Neither of the boys, nor Brian actually, has been in a helicopter or a hot air balloon. I think Brian's been in a helicopter. I know he hasn't been in a hot air balloon. Anyway, so that'll be a first for all of them. And then after our 3 nights there, we take another little plane a little bit further south and down into the depths of the Delta, near another private park. And we'll be there for 3 nights. Very similar kind of thing. You just see different types of animals, some different types of animals. And then at the end of those 3 nights there, we will drive out to this place called Sky Dads that is in the middle of nowhere. And it is 4 3-story towers, I guess, and one of them is like public space, I would say, for the other three. It's where you have cocktails in the evening and that kind of thing. You gather before dinner or breakfast or whatever. And then the other three are sleeping platforms and bathrooms and stuff. So the bottom level is ground level, and it has stairs that wind up to the other three levels. And the center level is partially enclosed, and it is the bathroom and changing room area. So it's partially enclosed in canvas, so you have some privacy. And obviously it's not plumbed. There's no plumbing. But when you want to shower, you just let them know half an hour in advance or something, and they warm up water over the fire, the campfire. And they bring it in a camp shower, so it's basically a big canvas bag, and it has a shower spigot at the bottom with a little turny thing, little handle thing, and you turn it on and off. You turn it on, wet yourself, turn it off, soap up, shower, you know, shampoo up, everything, turn it back on, rinse off, same thing. And so that is your shower. So we'll be there. And then the top is the sleeping platform, and that is completely open air. It's not enclosed at all. It has a bed, a 4-poster bed with mosquito netting that comes around, because it is in the Okavango Delta. There are mosquitoes and there is malaria, so I'll also be taking malaria prophylaxis, but you still don't want to get bitten. So it has mosquito netting, and it has a couch too. And these are all built facing a permanent water hole. And it's a man-made water hole, I believe, that there's been a well dug and that they pump into this water hole. But it attracts lots of animals, as you might imagine. And in addition to the platforms, there is also a hide. An animal hide where you can go into the hide. I don't mean hide like skin, I mean hide like a blind. where you can go in and watch the animals at eye level. So it's down in the ground. And you get pretty close. So that's exciting. So we'll be there for one night, and then we will fly a little plane up to Kisane, which is on the, it's in Botswana, but it's on the border of Zimbabwe. And get off, hop in the jeep, and drive 15 minutes to the border. And then we have to get out of that jeep, walk to the border, walk across the border, do all of our formalities, which can take a little while getting in and out of Zimbabwe. They're very careful with those borders. And we need to buy our visas and all that kind of thing. And then we'll get into a different vehicle on the Zimbabwe side and drive an hour and a half to Victoria Falls. Ooh, it might get noisy because it's just now starting to rain. Big, huge backdrops. And so I always, when I'm on safari, like to end, if I'm going to Victoria Falls, I like to end my trip there because safari is exhausting. You are up at 4:30 or 5 every morning, and you don't get to bed until 10:30 at night. And that's because generally your morning game drives are, depending on if it's winter or summer, are starting at 5 or 5:30. And you go out, you know, there's coffee and cookies and stuff set up, and you get up and stumble in, and everybody's looking like they've been dragged through a hedge backwards. You stumble in there, and you have your coffee and cookies, and then you get in your vehicle, and you do a game drive for 3.5 hours. 4 hours, maybe. And then you come back, have a, 15, 20 minutes to clean up, and then they serve breakfast. And then you have the rest of the afternoon to rest, which I recommend doing. Or you can go out on a bushwalk sometimes. There's usually a swimming pool. You can go into a pool, that kind of thing. We do a lot of napping at that time, because then about 3:30, 4 o'clock, they serve tea, afternoon tea and snacks. And then about 4:30, you go back out for your evening game drive, because of course animals are most active early in the morning and at dusk. And then also that leads over into nighttime, and you can then see the nocturnal animals. So from about 4:30 until 7:30, 8 o'clock, you're out on your game drive. You do stop for what they call sundowners, so it's snacks and cocktails, basically happy hour out in the bush. But you come back about 7:30, 8 o'clock, and then you have dinner. And then everybody's talking around the campfire, and you are not in bed before 10:30, and you're exhausted, and then you're up before 4:30 the next morning. So you do that for 9 nights in a row. In our case, we're doing it 10 nights, or however long you're doing it, for us 10 nights. And so you're tired by the end. So I like to end in Victoria Falls because it's kind of eases you back into civilization. It is a town, it's very international, lots of tourists, lots of restaurants, shops, that kind of thing. You're in a regular hotel with room service and pool and spa and on and on and on. Plumbing. That's always nice. So I'll be there 2 nights at a place called Ilala Lodge. And while we're there, we will do what's called the Flight of the Angels. And it is a helicopter over the falls. And to me, it's the best way to see the falls. You can walk along the rim, which is fine, but you don't see the whole falls from it. You walk along, and you're not even really on the rim. You're walking along the trail, and then there's like a little indentation, and you go into the indentation and you look at it and you're like, oh hey, there's the falls, and you're all wet because of the spray. Victoria Falls in the local language is called Musi Altunia, which means the smoke that thunders, because the spray is so huge during the time when the waters are high. It just roars, and you can see the spray for miles. It's amazing. But so you can walk, and I have done that walk. It's just not that impressive because you just don't see the grandeur of all the falls. So last time I was in Victoria Falls. I was there with my mother, and we did the Flight of the Angels. And it's not a very long, it's not a very long flight. It's only like 15 minutes in the air, but it lets you see the whole falls all at once, and it is amazing and absolutely breathtaking, and just you really see the grandeur of Victoria Falls. So we'll do that during the day, in the morning probably, and then that evening will be our last evening in Southern Africa, and so we will do a riverboat ride on the Zambezi River, and I'm not sure if we're going to do a dinner or if we're going to just have cocktails and snacks or what, but we'll have a boat and a captain taking us out, and that's how we're going to say goodbye to Africa. We're going to have a sunset cruise on the Zambezi River. So that should be really fun. We like to, when we take the kids places, we like to really end each, segment, each distinct part of the trip, so in this case, the Africa part of the trip, on a big note or a memorable note of some kind. So this will be their goodbye to Africa memorable note. And then the next day we will fly back to Johannesburg, because all roads lead to Johannesburg. And it's only about a 2.5 hour flight, it's pretty easy. And then we will catch our Emirates flight back to Dubai. And again, easy flight, 9 hours, overnight. Get in at like 5:30 in the morning. I think we go at 7:30 at night, get in at 5:30 in the morning. And then we'll spend 4 or 5 nights, I can't remember off the top of my head. I think five nights in Dubai, out in this area called Jumeirah Beach. And it's really nice, a couple of kilometers of private beach. It's in this resort called the Madinat. And I say resort, but it's like it is a resort, but it's not a resort as in it's a hotel, it's a resort area. And so there are, I think, 3 or 5 hotels, and then there's 29 or 30 villas, and 50 restaurants and bars, and it's built to be like an old Arabian town. They have their own souk that's very kind of authentic looking, Disney authentic, I guess. And so I thought it would be a good place for the kids, because they've never been to Dubai. Brian's never been to Dubai. I've been a few times. And so it's a place where they can be really independent and go off and do their own thing. The hotel is affiliated with a water park next door called Wild Wadi. And so they can go there, because it's going to be very hot. We're going to be there the first week of July. It will probably be 90 to 100 degrees, and the humidity, oddly enough, you wouldn't think of it being humid in the desert, but Dubai gets very humid in the summer, and so I bet the humidity is going to be 80% at least. So yeah, we're not going to be doing a whole lot of walking. Dubai's not really a walking place anyway, as you might imagine. it is much more of a place where you drive to your destination, you get out of your air conditioning car, you go to your air conditioned destination, and you stay there. So, a lot of shopping malls, that's why there's a lot of shopping malls, places like that. And so, there's also a metro that you can take, and there's a metro stop right by the Madinat, and you can take that to Mall of the Emirates, where they have that indoor ski slope at the Mall of the Emirates. So we can do that kind of thing, you know, if the kids get tired of lazing around on the beach, or in the heat of the afternoon. We tend to like to do the beach early, and then late, and in the heat of the day, do other stuff that's indoors. We may go next door to Abu Dhabi, it's just a couple hours away, it's a different emirate, and interesting place. It has, yeah, I mean, interesting things. It's got Ferrari World and a gorgeous hotel called the Palace and a stunning mosque. So we might take the boys there. Anyway, so we'll be there for 5 nights and then we will fly home. Now we are whole trip. And that almost took me as long, I bet, it seemed to you to tell me about it as it will for me to take the trip. I'm sorry. You did say you were interested. I should have done a disclaimer at the beginning and said, this is going to be long. Anyway. All right, you guys. It's been 30 minutes. I'm going to let you go. I hope you have a fabulous weekend. It's weird weather here. Like I said, it just started to rain. Big, huge raindrops. It's blue sky over there, and it's dark black sky over here. And so we're having very bipolar weather at the moment, but Sunday is supposed to be nice. And then next week's supposed to be crazy hot. It's going to be like, well, they say 97 on Monday. I don't know. I'll leave it when I see it. Spence is pretty excited because today was his last day at school, and so he can use the pool. We're going to be tearing off our deck. Decks. We have 3 levels of decking on our house, and that's going to be coming off in the second week of July, so the pool will be out of commission from the middle of July until October. So he's got to get his pool time in. I will talk to you later. Have a fabulous weekend.